Good afternoon and welcome to worship with Crescentville and Frankford Memorial United Methodist Churches in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. It's good to have you worshiping with us this morning on this fourth Sunday in Advent. I'd like to start by reminding us that we have a birthday actually today, Fiona Peters. Happy birthday. Incidentally, if you would let the office know if you've got birthdays coming up or anniversaries, we'll be sure that they get recognized. It's important for the family of God to know when these things are happening. Remember that today we are going to be lighting our Advent candles, so please have your Advent candles ready. And also stay on at the end of the service today, because we will be doing greetings for each other if you would like to. A reminder that our Advent Bible study is 7 o'clock this Wednesday. The topic is Jesus, the light of the world. And this will be our fourth and last week. However, you do not have to have been to the others. You can come on and join with us this Wednesday, 7 o'clock. Our Christmas Eve worship service will be Thursday at 7, and the link is different than what you have signed up for this worship service. So please check your email. The link will be emailed to you. If you don't have it, call the office and leave word, and we'll see that you get it. I would like to announce at this time our chorus of worship, of welcome, rather, our family of God. And at this time, family, let us do our call to worship together. This is the season of holy waiting. We watch for the one who scatters the proud and lifts up the lowly. We wait for the day when our spirits will rejoice to know God's favor. We watch while the light of day begins to fill the sky. Come. Let us walk in the light of God. And our opening hymn is, My Soul Gives Glory to My God.
Of God.
Now it's time for our Advent candle lighting. And this morning, our candle lighters are the Jean family. Jean, Magenta, Marina, Mariah, and Mallory.
I will sing of the Lord's great love forever. With my mouth, I will make your faithfulness known through all generations. I will declare that your love stands firm forever, that you have established your faithfulness in heaven itself. You said, I have made covenant with my chosen one. I have sworn to David, my servant, I will establish your line forever and make your throne firm through all generations.
Luke 1:47-55. And my spirit rejoices in God, my Savior, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the mighty one has done great things for me. Holy is his name. His mercy extends to those who fear him from generation to generation. He has performed mighty deeds with his arms. He has scattered those who are proud in their innermost thoughts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones, but has lifted up the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things, but has sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel, remembering to be merciful to Abraham and his descendants forever, just as he promised our ancestors.
Jesus is coming, and we are preparing to welcome him again into the world and into our lives. We light the Advent candles to celebrate the life we are given and to name the gifts we can offer to others.
Last Sunday, we lit the candle of joy. We light it in the candles of hope and peace again in gratitude.
The summest signs of God's steadfast love, God's faithfulness as firm as the heavens. The gospel describes God's love. It blesses us. It is merciful, strong, and protective. It is benevolent and true.
The fourth candle of Advent is the candle of love. Jesus showed us God's perfect love.
Just as a candle shines and welcomes in a window, so God's love invites and welcomes us home. Just as the glow of birthday candles reflects love and celebration, God's gift of Jesus reflects the greatest love for us.
Please join in singing, "The Light of the World is Jesus."
Love is also a gift we give to others.
Though in the example of God's perfect love, we offer love to others that is patient, kind, respectful, and enduring. There's no greater light than the light of his righteousness, in which we must light up everyone in our world. Let the gospel fire burn in us and through us. Let us be the light of the and love of the world. Let us pray together. Loving God, we thank you for the gift of love shown to us perfectly in Jesus. You have given us so much. Help us to give those who need our gifts. Help us today and every day to be grateful, to hear your word, and to do your will by sharing joy with others. As we ask this in the name of the one born to us. Amen.
Please join in singing, O come, Emmanuel.
That was beautiful. Thank you. And now we'll have our children's message from Sue Snyder.
Did you ever think about your name? The significance, the meaning, or if you were named for someone? My name, I think it was purely that in the 50s, it was a popular name. I know my husband, Rich, his brother got to name him, and he was named for the baseball player, Richie Ashburn. When I think of Joseph and Mary, they didn't get a chance to name and choose a name. An angel told Mary, "You will have a son, and his name will be Jesus." Jesus is a very important name. The Bible says there's no other name that can save us from sin. Our names are important too, but there's none other like Jesus. It makes me think of that song, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. There's something about that name. Master, Savior, Jesus, like the fragrance after the rain. Jesus, 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 let all heaven and earth proclaim. Kings and kingdoms will all pass away, but there's something about that name. Thanks.
Thank you, Sue. Well, at least you seem to have thawed out enough that you can talk now once we get you up. Sue was on board yesterday with all of the young people for the drive-by. And so we want to thank you for everyone who attended. A special thank you to the young people and the leaders who stood out there in the cold for that time. And so God bless everyone. It was a good time by all. In our joys and concerns, first of all, the Grabowski family, Kathleen McClellan Grabowski, that's the mother of Lauren Pleiss, the wife of Kyle Pleiss. Kathleen passed away Thursday. Kyle is the grandson of Ron and Jean Pleiss. Please keep this family in prayer. Also, Christopher Naimo, friend of Doc Gallagher, is fighting cancer now. Keep him in your prayers. And Larry Burns, another friend of Doc, thanks us for our prayers. He's now in remission from his rare lymphoma. Stephen Everett, my nephew, I had asked for prayer before for him. He had heart surgery and he is now at home and recuperating. I have a friend, Frank, whose daughter lives in South Carolina. His daughter spends every other year for Thanksgiving, the major holidays, between the families. And this year was her husband's family. They were all together near South Carolina. They had 20 people gather for their Thanksgiving big family celebration. Right now, all but one of those 20 people have been affected by the coronavirus, and a couple of them are in serious condition right now. It's just a reminder that we know the holidays and we have the big Christmas holiday coming up. It's important that we maintain the necessary things that we have to do. We have to maintain social distancing, and we have to, as much as I hate to say it, minimize our time with our families. So just keep that in mind. This is a serious time and a serious situation. Also, a note that Jenny Brubaker, Jenny Flynn now, graduated yesterday with her master's degree from the University of Florida. So congratulations to Jenny. Will you join me now as we go to the Lord in prayer? Heavenly Father, we pray to you because you want us to, because you made us to. On this fourth Advent Sunday, we recognize the love that came into the world with your Son, Jesus, who was born to be our Savior and save us from our sins. We pray for your Holy Spirit, who resides in you and also in us. And we pray for ourselves, individually and collectively, because we have not fully accepted the greatest gift for all, the gift of love, given especially for us, the gift of Jesus Christ. And what can this Jesus gift do? He can save us from our sins, make us whole and right in your sight. He can help us through our trials, share the load when we're overburdened, and help us show love to others when on our own we'd rather not. He gave us our moral compass to not just be do-gooders, but to actually do good. We thank you for this church, its leaders, its teachers, its supporters, and for its pastor, the Reverend Randy Brubaker. We thank you for blessings, for family, for healings. We thank you for being here to support us through difficult times, even when we don't immediately see your blessings, or our family is in disarray, or healings are not coming in the way and in the time we wanted. So thank you, God, for Jesus, whose birth is remembered this Advent season. Thank you, Jesus, for remembering us. And now let's pray together the prayer Jesus taught for his disciples, including us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts and trespasses, as we forgive our debtors and those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now it's time to go into our time of sharing, our time of giving. Lord, we realize that we are a blessed people, especially at this time of year when thoughtful giving and gracious receiving become the norm for many of us, while many others of us are still not quite sure what to give and how to receive. Knowing that you gave your Son for us does not make us want to give up our children in the same way, but it does make us want to acknowledge your gift for us. The gift of salvation, a gift meant to be given away or shared with others. And now, as we consider our gift to our church, whether we give at this time by mail or drop off or electronically, we are encouraged to give generously. We hear and we respond. Amen. Lord, today we lit the candle of love, acknowledging your love for us and setting the goal of our love for others. Continue to bless us as we continue to share your love with all those touched by the work of your church. Amen. And now our next hymn is To a Maid Engaged to Joseph. Listen verses 1-3. Good afternoon. It is good to be here. It is good to be together. I really appreciated the togetherness that was experienced outside the parsonage door by the corner at Hasbrook and Centner for the drive-by yesterday. It was so wonderful to see so many of you and to catch up a little bit, to see how much the young people are growing taller than me. That's a little depressing, but it's good to see them growing, and it's certainly good to be together today for worship. As we hear this lesson from Luke's gospel, I want to encourage us, and hopefully we've been doing this, but I've been reminded of this recently, that in the context of worship, how important it is to center ourselves into what we're doing. Outside of our sanctuaries, we're a little more distracted, I will admit. I have cookies sitting here in front of me. I have a window that I can see outside beside me. I have occasionally seeing our cats going by. There's reason for distraction, and it causes me to be that much more focused on this computer, because through this computer, we communicate. And through this means of technology, we have this opportunity to share together in God's word. And so as we hear this lesson today, as we hear the word of God spoken, let us be mindful that it is God speaking to us as we hear these words. From the Gospel of Luke, chapter 1, verses 26 through 38. In the 6 months of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. And he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born, even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age. And she who is said to be unable to conceive is in her sixth month. For no word from God will ever fail." "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May your word to me be fulfilled." Then the angel left her. This is the word of our Lord. Thanks be to God. God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, to a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. Mary and Joseph were connected. They were connected to a family, to each other's, to their families, enough so that those families saw it right to arrange the marriage of Joseph and of Mary. They were promised to one another through their families, and through their connectedness, they thought they knew how things were going to play out, that they would have this time of betrothal. They would have this time of preparation in which there was a sense of connection already developed between Joseph and Mary, and yet marriage had not been finalized for them. They were simply in a time of preparation. We today might call that engagement, where two persons promise themselves to each other. Often it's involving other family members, but most important in our culture is that two persons make a promise to one another, and they prepare themselves for the ultimate promise of full commitment in marriage. But I share that to kind of in some ways bringing in what Miss Sue shared with us, that we're named, all of us, you know, all of us children, we're given names by our parents, for some for reasons beyond the simpleness of a name. Some had connections with other family members. Some we simply liked the name, or it was trendy at the time. But we're all named for someone. We're all named at all. We're given names in our birth. And Mary and Joseph, I would imagine, as they pursued and prepared for marriage, considered the fact the idea that they would have children. Not knowing, of course, at the time that Mary would have a child, not with Joseph's help, but by the gift of God and the power of the Holy Spirit. And as Miss Sue shared with our young people, and all of us heard it, they didn't get to name this child. Instead, this child's name was given to him by God. "You will call him Jesus." Jesus, which means salvation. Jesus, which means and prepares us to know that God was about to do something wondrous in the earth.
to provide salvation for all. Being right with God is very important. Being right with each other is very important. I just had a conversation recently with someone who said to me that they said some things they shouldn't have to someone. We talked about how hard that must have been, not only for the person who heard these not so good words, but also for the person who spoke them to realize that they shouldn't have done that. And we spoke about what we can do about that. And I simply made a suggestion. I said, why don't you write a note and just let this person know that you're sorry and open the door for righteousness to happen between the two of you, goodness to happen, forgiveness to happen. Jesus is that letter from God to all of us, simply letting us know that God has made a way for us to be right with God. And that's a wondrous thing to know, because when we all get to that point of realizing that our lives don't measure up to God, when we have so many shortcomings in our lives and we don't know what to do, this story of Christmas is a reminder that God has reached out to us and provided for us salvation, right living. And Mary, when we think about this, Mary, a young person herself, can you imagine what it must have been for that angel to appear to her and to give her the message that he gave, telling her that you have found favor with God and that you will conceive, you will give birth to a son by the Holy Spirit, not by Joseph, but by the Holy Spirit. And you are to call him Jesus. He will be great. He will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. All of a sudden, Mary, I'm sure, was perplexed, not sure, overwhelmed. We can only go on and on with the thoughts of what she must have been feeling when she heard this news. Simply, she asks the question, how will this be? I'm a virgin. How can I conceive a child? And of course, the angel goes on to tell her, the Holy Spirit will come on you. The power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. You, Mary, will conceive the Holy One, the one through whom only God can bring. And God does that because you're a virgin. God will do such a thing. Nothing, the angel goes on to say, is impossible with God. Just as Sarah and Abraham in their old age were able to conceive Isaac, just as Elizabeth in her old age was able to conceive. And Mary, as she listened to this angel, as she long to know the answer to her question, how will this be? She continued to listen and heard the wondrous message that this angel brought. She listened to the point where she was able to answer finally in these last words of the passage we read today. Mary answered, "May your word to me be fulfilled. Yes, Lord, I give myself to you." And then the angel left her. Now, there is more to this story, and we will celebrate the more of this story, namely the birth of Jesus, as we gather together for worship on Thursday night. But without the words of Mary, may your word be fulfilled. That story would not be the story we've come to know. Mary's willingness to say yes to God was what made this story so wondrous. And God may not have visited us through an angel in the same way that he visited Mary. But each and every day, God visits us with opportunities to make God known. And each and every day, we're given the opportunity to say with her, may your word be fulfilled. May your will be done. May you live and work through me. Whatever it is, O God, that you would do, whoever it is that you would be through me, be that one. As we prepare in these coming days to celebrate joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let's not forget Mary's willingness to say, your word be fulfilled. Let us not forget the willingness of Mary to simply say, let it be what God would want. Let that be and let that happen as a result of what I've heard. And know today, whatever opportunity that will be yours tomorrow will be a similar opportunity for you to say, may your word, O God, be fulfilled. Would it be reaching out to a neighbor? Might it be mending things between you and a spouse? Might it be a mom or a dad and their children with strife and needing to reaffirm the love that is shared in family? Whatever the opportunity is, know that God gives us these opportunities every day. And we can take heart and encouragement from Mary's response to such an awesome thing. Mary said, let it be your will. Whatever it is, I will do it. And because of that, we honor Mary. Because of that, we realize her obedience is a standard that we long to follow. When we think on Mary today and in the days to come, may we do so with grateful hearts. May we realize in her is an example for us to follow. Amen. As a way of expressing that desire to follow, let us affirm our faith in God together through the words of the affirmation of faith, the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, the life everlasting. Amen. And now let us sing together the final three verses of the hymn To a Maid Engaged to Joseph.
How shall they
Behold, I am your handmaid, Mary said unto her God. So be it, I am ready according to your word. Go with this same willingness that Mary had to give yourself anew to God, submitting to whatever his will would be for your life, and knowing in all things he will care for you, provide for you, and as you trust in him, through you will God will do great things. Please be reminded that on Thursday, again, this coming Thursday, Christmas Eve, we will join together for worship here through Zoom at 7 p.m. You will be sent a link through the email and be able to connect with us that way. But we hope that many will be able to come together as we gather for our worship on Christmas Eve. God bless you all. Realize God's presence and power both now and forevermore. Amen. Amen. And please do know that you're invited to stay to greet one another as we take this time to do so following our service. God bless you all. It's good to see you again.